Windows phone designed to get you in and out so you can actually watch the game.
When you absolutely, positively have to get it there on Monday night, FedEx Field in the nation's capital. Tonight, a partisan crowd on hand to watch an NFC East rivalry renewed. Two teams with their sights set on a division title. The Philadelphia Eagles against the Washington Redskins. All on quarterbacks. Coming up next on
Monday Night Countdown.
Welcome to Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's.
Beautiful sight of the nation's capital, maybe not for the football team that plays there. Michael Vick plays the way he's been playing quarterback this year for the Philadelphia Eagles. And did someone say quarterback of the Philadelphia Eagles? For 11 years, that was his job. Donovan McNabb, of course, trying to make it 2-for-2 as a Redskin quarterback, starting against his old team. And welcome everybody to Monday Night Countdown. Beware the Ides of November. I'm Chris Berman. Glad you can be with us for the next 90 minutes. Coach Ditka, are you
Halloween, partisan? Halloween, getting ready for Halloween.
Look at this. Let us be the last to wish you a happy Halloween. Keyshawn Johnson, you suit very nicely.
Very mad, though.
Monday. We're going to get on. Chris Carter. Nice to see you.
Good seeing you both.
All you guys look tight there.
We try to keep it.
Tom Jackson, very autumnal.
Always.
Adam Mort coming up, and a cast of thousands navigate the beltway ahead as we get you set for 90 minutes to get you set for McNabb versus Philly Part 2. But we begin with the story that's filibustered the D.C. headlines lately. Washington is a city that tends to shrug its shoulders as it happens all the time. But every once in a while, change happens in Washington that catches even the most unflappable a little bit off guard. On Halloween in Detroit, with less than 2 minutes to go and a chance for the go-ahead score, Coach Mike Shanahan pulled quarterback Donovan McNabb for Rex Grossman. You didn't need a Zogby poll to figure out it didn't work out. Well, that change unleashed a controversy that's become the talk of the town, even in election month.
Rex knowing how to run that two-minute offense, I felt with the time and no timeouts gave us the best chance to win.
Decision was made, and I went with it.
He understood why he did it. I believe he did.
When you get benched, you get benched.
I don't think any quarterback likes it. The cardiovascular endurance that it takes to run a two-minute going all the way down, no timeouts, calling plays, it just doesn't, just not easy. You really put yourself out in any type of strenuous activities.
That is hilarious to me. That is really funny to me.
You're always right. Sometimes you go with your gut, but the bottom line is you make it and you go on.
Well, that was then. This is now. Today, off the field, McNabb agreed to a 5-year, $78 million extension, $40 million guaranteed with the Redskins. So we bring in Adam Schefter from bench to well-paid. Why now?
Well, boom, this is a deal that was negotiated since the Redskins have been playing the Philadelphia Eagles. The same deal that was agreed to today actually was agreed to in early October before the Redskins played the Eagles. And McNabb's agent, Fletcher Smith, arrived in Washington, met with Eric Schaefer, one of the Redskins' vice presidents, and simply took the deal that the two sides have been talking about since early October.
And for Donovan McNabb, listen, everybody knows he's a great guy. But until you actually see these deals on paper, which nobody has seen, yep, be careful. There's been a lot of deals. These numbers might be real, but they may not kick in until an option is exercised. I've been told that this deal will allow the Redskins to walk away without paying a lot of money. He gets about almost $10 million in new money, but let's wait about 48 hours before we really see the contract to describe this as a blockbuster, shocking deal.
All right, Mort, you're going to Watergate it and get it for us and take a look at it and tell us what you think. Thanks, Mort and Adam. Back to you guys shortly. So what's our reaction to all this? Interesting timing.
Well, and that would be the thing. You listen to that story, you listen to the buildup over the course of the last 2 weeks. You know, look, I'm from Cleveland. This has the smell of hush money. Take what
Tom.
Chris Mortensen.
Tom.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yeah. I think that, you know, the situation and the frustration that Coach Shanahan showed toward Donovan McNabb certainly doesn't coincide with $78 million and $40 million guaranteed. Now, I don't think that the situation can be reconciled, because I think that there's a trust between coach and quarterback that you have in order to maximize both. And I don't think that these two people will ever have that.
Well, Tommy, that is true. But right now, going through NFL players' homes, their family, uneasiness with the labor piece, all right? A new contract is good news in the NFL. There are a lot of guys that want a new contract. We've heard people talk about it. You know, we don't know what's going to happen in the future. But when someone, your employer, who happens to be a billionaire, comes down and gives you new money, all right, I'd be careful, too. I don't like to count other people's money in the NFL. But everyone's in business for themselves. McNabb's got to do what's best for him.
Yeah.
I think that deal was a good deal for him.
I'm not saying turn down $78 million by any means. And I'm glad for Donovan McNabb. I'm just saying there's something that just doesn't go together.
My boss, about Shanahan.
I'm a linebacker. There's something here that doesn't go together. I'm a linebacker. That's it.
You play linebacker.
Yeah.
I'm happy for Donovan.
Oh, yeah.
Whatever. Funny money, whatever the case is, I'm happy for Donovan. Because if he signed a deal, which we assume that he did, and he is, that he knows who he's dealing with in the Shanahans. Not one Shanahan, but two. I know I'm dealing with Boone, okay? I know I'm dealing with Tom and Coach and Chris. I understand who these guys are.
Mm-hmm.
So if he decides that he's going to say things about me, I'm not surprised. If he's going to tell his little buddies on the coaching circuit things about me, I'm not surprised. I know who this guy is. So now I can play within myself and do what I need to do for my football team, for the owner that has given me this contract, and be happy with myself. And I believe that's the way Donovan is feeling.
Well, the simple fact is we know, the fans know, the owner knows. If this team's going to go anywhere, it's going to go somewhere with Donovan McNabb at quarterback. Mm-hmm. Let me say one thing. If they win tonight, guys, you got to understand it. They're 3-0 in the division. Mm-hmm. They really control that aspect of it. They're one game behind. They've got to win this football game. That's the most important to them. I'll say this about Donovan McNabb. I believe he can forgive. I just don't think he'll ever forget.
No, I agree. We're all thrilled for him. We know what a class professional and a class act he's been. And so because of his class and Shanahan, Coach Shanahan certainly has been around and understands things. They, I think, considering these two, will move forward better than many others in this position could. And that being said, to me, what this looks like is the owner desperate to win. And they won only four games last year. It's the first time he's, without saying anything, Daniel Snyder, what can I do to keep us in the hunt, which we're in at 4-4? How about moving this forward right now? Now, I know that may not quite be, but that's what it looks like to me. And I didn't play linebacker, Tom. That's what it looks like to me. And I'm not even from but that's what it looks like to me. And, you know, let's hope for the Redskins' sake that it all works out. Let's go to Susie Kalber, who, of course, is at FedEx Field. And, Suze, good evening to you. And let's go back to the benching. What are the Redskins saying about how this was all handled? You've been there.
Well, you're right, because both sides have worked so hard to make all of this right. And Mike Shanahan told us the way he handled it was clumsy. But it went back to the Tuesday before the game when McNabb's hamstring was so bad, Shanahan didn't even think he was going to play and considered saving him for the second half of the season. And then he candidly admitted to us that in the post-game press conference, he's not the kind of coach who's going to and give the real reason why he benched his quarterback. He just never thought that the things he said were going to spiral the way they did. So he talked to Donovan on the phone Monday. On Tuesday, Donovan left for Phoenix on Wednesday because it was the bye week. Bruce Allen flew down there late in the week to talk. And by the time Donovan and Mike Shanahan were face to face on Monday, a week ago today, it was already water under the bridge. They were both ready to move on. But Kyle Shanahan said it best. He said he was very apologetic. He was really bothered by the way things were portrayed. And he said, honestly, he just wished his dad had been honest and had come out and said, We just didn't think Donovan was playing very well.
Susie, well, now let's move forward, all right? So that's backwards 2 weeks, the bye week, as you point out. What are the real issues that were addressed during the bye week and perhaps this week as well?
Number one was Donovan's health. It was the hamstring. Now he's had time to heal. He told us he's not 100%, but he's not using that as an excuse. The other thing was the offensive line. They've had so many different combinations. They weren't able to protect him. Now those guys are pretty healthy. Kyle Shanahan, of course, explained very difficult for a quarterback to play 11 years in one system and then come into a new system and be automatic under fire. They're not saying he doesn't know the system. He does, but needs to be automatic under fire. He also, at this point in his career, maybe needs to address his body in a different way. I spoke to Donovan just a minute ago. He said he is very happy, and now Chris just wants to play the game.
Well, and it is against the Eagles, so by the way, a game that means a little something to him. Again, Suze, thank you. We'll hear from you a little bit later. And, of course, across the field, Michael Vick will be playing for Philadelphia, talking with another guy who could run the ball and throw the ball pretty well, who threw it from the same port side, if you will. Our Steve Young. We'll go to the guys on the field soon. We'll hear from Donovan later in the show as we get you set for this critical NFC East showdown. Will Donovan McNabb be able to sweep his former team this season? We'll be back. Monday Night Countdown, just kicking it off.
America's college football teams embark on a quest.
Nice move, and he will score.
To conquer the grueling season in pursuit of one common goal, a national championship.
It's outside on the right. 3-2-1, touchdown.
The drama unfolds each week as the top teams and biggest rivals battle on ESPN.
Breaks tackles down the sideline. He's going to score.
College football lives here.
He's at the 20. Breaks the tackle. Touchdown, Ricky Williams. Get pressure. Goes down again.
Another huge pass rush by the Miami Dolphins. And the Dolphins have the interception.
Vontae Davis, welcome to the National Football League.
Getting under center.
Fires deep downfield.
Touchdown, Dolphins.
Brown will take a direct snap. Breaks one tackle, moves to the right. He's going to get to the end zone. Oh. Touchdown, Dolphins.
Goes up the middle. Touchdown, Dolphins.
All right, Miami.
Won it in 09, and last year they came up a little short. Wouldn't call the Penguins losing in the second round of the playoffs last year underachieving, but a few people did.
Listen, I've heard the club called the next dynasty in hockey. And right or wrong, that word dynasty, it comes with certain expectations.
Long offseason for the Penguins, but you got to think they're going to come back this year hungrier than ever, because once you've lifted the Stanley Cup, all you want to do is lift it again.
Yeah, this team clearly has the drive of a winner, but do they still have the drive of a champion?
Can't stop him.
Hand off Adrian, and he's loose. Adrian bounces off a lion. Across the 50. Cuts back to the right to the 40. Cuts back to the right. Breaks the tackle inside the 20.
We can't lead this drive without seven, man.
Adrian up the middle. Bumps it out to the left to the 15. Sprints inside the 5. And it's an Adrian Peterson touchdown.
ESPN America Moments.
Again, they go with that power eye formation. Brady will throw with time. Ball's in the air. Touchdown. Aaron Hernandez. Carroll.
Countdown is served by Applebee's. Try Applebee's new flavor-loaded steaks. Come see what's cooking today. And in part by Wells Fargo Advisors. And Verizon, the official wireless service provider of the NFL.
We like to think that this is a larger-than-life show. Tonight, we have proof as we fly over FedEx Field like one of Fred Smith's planes landing from Memphis. Coach, I got to tell you, you still look marvelous. You look marvelous. To our teammate Steve Young, you played marvelous. But tonight, Michael Vick needs his 25 yards rushing to pass you for second all-time on the quarterback rushing list. To our ball club at field level, Steve, Matt Millen, and Stuart Scott. Stuart?
Boom, Vic probably will pass Steve Young on the all-time QB rushing list. But Steve, 232 career touchdown passes. Michael, your 79 is nice. Still got a ways to go.
But hey, Michael, I mean, I'm inspired by his play this year and the foundation of how he's done it. He has gained perspective from his experience and from his time in prison. And he's come out, and he could have been played the victim. He could have been full of vengeance. And teach me, coach me, show me how to be a great football player. And he has done that, and we're starting to see the fruits of it. Personally, this is the Michael Vick I dreamed of seeing when he came out of college, when I used to talk to him and say, look, if you can learn to throw the football from the pocket, deliver the football, and also use your legs outside the pocket when it was time, you actually learn the quarterback job, you could be the greatest weapon at quarterback has ever been in the NFL.
The greatest weapon ever at quarterback.
Well, that's obvious, though. With his physical skills, and he plays the position, which is deliver the ball from the pocket, reading, eye level, footwork. If he can do that and learn that, and there's a lot of mobile quarterbacks that just didn't make that commitment or that transition. If you can and you have your legs, you can be the greatest weapon in the history of the game at the position of quarterback.
That's awesome.
Matt, what do you see about Vic playing this year that you didn't see last year when he first came back?
Yeah, that's a great question, because when Michael Vick came back, you looked at him and you wanted to know where was he, because with the time off, generally, you know, if you don't use it, you lose it. And you started to watch him and thought, this might be a guy who lost a little bit of it. But as the season went on and you watched him, and I came back to training camp this year and I watched him and go, ooh, those flashes are there. He looked like he was back in shape. He was more decisive. Most importantly, Steve, what you said, his eyes when he takes off and run, his eyes are up looking to make a play with his arm.
The foundation of great quarterbacks is footwork. Look at Tom Brady, Peyton Manning. That begets accuracy and then eye level. Two things that Michael did not thrive at before. And is this, I can't wait to watch him tonight to see if this progress keeps moving in the right direction. I'm giddy about his progress this year and how well he's playing football.
Steve once had a 100-yard rushing game playing running back in the old USFL, but Michael Vick's 9 100-yard rushing games, most ever for an NFL QB. And back in 02, he had a 173-yard game, again, biggest ground game ever for an NFL QB. But the measure of an NFL quarterback is passing. And if you take a look, Michael's first 7 seasons, the passing game, not so much. Completed only 53% of his throws. And passer rating, no thanks. But this year, no interceptions. Top-rated QB in the NFL. Doing work with Moreeeee and Vick, the Eagles, and what Michael Vick still won't do. Here's Michelle Tafoya with the team report. Michelle?
Well, Stuart, Michael Vick is a quarterback, but he says when he tucks the football and takes off running, he feels like a running back. Still, he is a 30-year-old quarterback who needs to protect himself, but whenever he's taken off running, he has never chosen to slide when the defense is coming. Now, Andy Reid told us last night he's not going to slide, or if he is, he's going to go head first, which defeats the purpose. So I asked Vic why he won't slide, and he said, after he paused for a second, I'm scared. He said, scared of what? And he said, getting his cleat caught and jamming his knee. He'd rather take a hit to his head than hurt his lower body. And Stuart, I think Reed would be happy just to see him make progress and get out of bounds when he's running with the football.
There you go, Michelle. There is an out of bounds on the football field. Michael, get there. Hey, after you make this catch, where do you go? Disneyland? How about Bristol, Connecticut? Mike Thomas in our studios to discuss the most talked about play from Sunday. And how about them Cowboys? Cowboys came to New York and worked the Giants. Why Coach and Chris are believers in Jason Garrett. All that's coming. Don't move.
You are watching Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's.
I'm J.W. Stewart. Join us Tuesday for SportsCenter on ESPN America for all the highlights and reaction from the Eagles-Redskins game on Monday Night Football. And in the NBA, the undefeated New Orleans Hornets are in Dallas against Dirk and the Mavs, while Kevin Durant and the Thunder roll into Salt Lake City to face the Jazz. Plus, in the NHL, the 12-3 Kings go swimming with the Sharks, and the Flyers host Ottawa. All this and more Tuesday on SportsCenter on ESPN America.
The Chiefs are out of the gate 3-1 for the first time since the last time they started 3-1. This blueprint for NFL success is now being used by high school teams nationwide, including the Eden Prairie Minnesota Eagles.
Coach, why did you start using this drill?
You know, I have no earthly idea.
The players have embraced the new drills with youthful enthusiasm.
It's the stupidest drill I've ever taken part in. Next thing you know, they're gonna have us kicking the porta potty itself. Sometimes the players don't understand why we have them do what we have them do.
Whoa, whoa, whoa!
Sometimes there's 29 days in February, sometimes there's not. Explain that one to me.
Yeah, that should come in handy. Next time it's in the porta potty on a 15-yard out.
I really thought I'd stay with my block this time, but now I'm pooped. Get it?
What drill is that guy doing?
Dude, he's not doing a drill. It's a porta potty. School lunch is here.
There are over 400,000 NCAA student athletes, and just about all of us will be going pro in something other than sports.
Skeptic or Believer is brought to you by New Gillette Fusion Pro Glide. Turn shaving into gliding and skeptics into believers.
Nothing skeptical about our 16th president, we can tell you that. But in football, tonight's skeptic or believer topic, Jason Garrett. 1-0 as Cowboys coach after the Cowboys shocked the G-men 33-20. Coach Chris, do you believe?
I believe because of the old show, Law and Order. He laid the law down, he created some order, and if you don't have discipline, somebody's got to give it to you. He's giving it to them.
I'm definitely, when you get guys, professional athletes, to play hard for you, I don't believe there's a lot of people qualified to be a head coach because they can't motivate professional athletes. He was able to do that. I'm a believer.
He should retire now with his winning percentage better than Tom Landry.
Give him the job.
That's it. Give him the job. One more hit. Texans, Jaguars, what a finish this was, huh? Yeah, but we had fun on the blitz with this one. But this is the play. There's nothing but about this. David Garrard throws it from the 50, deflected into the hands of Mike Thomas. The Hail Mary answered. Jags 31, Texans 24. For more on the Hail Mary that was answered, Mike Thomas right here. Fellas, you're towering over him.
Thanks, Boom. I got the good hands team. Mike Thomas joining us, the hero from yesterday. Talk to me about the play.
Most time in a situation like that, you know, the objective is the DB. They try to knock it down, try to disgrace the play. And, you know, I'm coming in, scoop it right up, touchdown, 6 points.
Let's work on it.
Well, let's work on it. Hail Mary. Now, typically what we do, we try to get in a trips formation. That means three receivers to one side. Okay. We get either our biggest or our most athletic guy on the outside. You're going to be the defender, okay. All right? This is the goal line. We're going to try to throw the ball into the goal line. That's why it was important for Antoine.
Well, I've been saying knock it down for 2 decades.
Well, also, the offense has adjusted to your knock it down. We've heard your knock it down. So we have our biggest guy. He's either trying to catch it or bat it back to us. We're in trips. So now we got two guys, Tommy, for the scoop. You've been saying for 20 years, we've been waiting for 20 years for the opportunity.
Yes, sir.
My man Mike's the one who benefited from it.
Take us on home, baby.
How hard to focus on that ball when it was being batted to?
Definitely, you got to have your wits up. You know, okay. being able to grab that out of the quick reflexes like that, it was big, man. And we was able to hold on to it and get the victory.
You got a set of hands there.
You practiced this, what, once a week, some sort of walkthrough, not full speed?
Right. That's exactly how we do it. Once a week, man, you know, the game, getting in your final preparations for the game, we run through it, you know, and we just go out there and do it when,
so
when the time is called.
The city?
No, not yet. I'm still waiting on that, man. We waiting on the key to
what do receivers do, though, when they score?
Oh, Philly,
y'all
show
ready?
Get it, poppin'.
Get it, baby.
Show the people, man.
Back to you, Boone.
Yeah, Mike is coachable, isn't he? That's why he's playing for Jack Del Rio. For more news and notes, let's throw to a Hail Mary to guys coachable. I don't know. Mort and Adam in the Verizon Red Zone. Fellas?
Well, let's talk about some coaches and the AFC West and those great rivalries in that division. Yes, they have been reborn, and it was reborn certainly again at Mile High Stadium in Vesco Field, where Todd Haley of the Chiefs refused to shake Josh McDaniel's hands after the game, actually offered him a finger, and basically said, I'll see you next time, which is December 5th, by the way, at Arrowhead. And the reason why is that he felt that the Broncos were blitzing and still running up the score in that 49-29 loss. Now, the other problem was, last year, Haley felt he called off the dogs when the Chiefs beat the Broncos 44-24. The day Todd Haley apologized, said he let his emotions get away from him.
Mort, after missing a 26-yard field goal last night, Jeff Reed is on the brink in Pittsburgh. The Steelers are contemplating cutting the kicker that has made only 15 of 22 field goals this season. Keep in mind, he was the Steelers' franchise player last offseason. Disappointed he didn't get the long-term deal and has not kicked overly well this season. The interesting part about it is that the Cincinnati Bengals also need a kicker because Mike Nugent is out for the year with a season-ending knee injury. So the Bengals and Steelers both looking for kickers this week.
Ocho Cinco can kick. Boom.
The Verizon Red Zone is brought to you by Verizon, the official wireless service provider of the NFL.
Coming up on Monday Night Countdown, listen up, Minnesota. I'm going to tell you why you should put the 41-year-old on the bench.
Well, Key, you might have to be the one to tell him because I've got 300 reasons why Brett is not going to do that.
Oh, let me have that, Tommy. Let's talk Eagles. That's the team that drafted me. Coach, I believe the wide receivers and the quarterback
got a chance to be real special coming down the stretch.
Well, one team put on a very special performance yesterday, and I'm going to tell you why once again they reminded me of why I love this game.
Moments.
And the cast, and there's the Vernon Davis, and Vernon Davis maybe stopped at the 1 yard line. The ball is over before his knee hits.
Clearly a touchdown right there.
On stopping on third down, and Batch goes for the big ball. What a catch! Antoine Randall inside the one. Washington for 34.
18 carries for 107 yards on the day, and he's adding more. Look at that move to the end zone for the touchdown.
Jacksonville looking for the win. Scobie sweeps the leg. 59 yards away. He's got it. Jacksonville wins. 31-28. Scobie the hero, a 59-yard field goal, and the Jaguars knock off the Colts.
College football lives here on ESPN America. Every Saturday, Chris Fowler and the gang get you ready for the matchups on ESPN's all-new 3-hour College Game Day. Then, catch live games from campuses across the U.S. Want even more college football action? We've got it all. Tons of bowl games, including every game in the Bowl Championship Series and the BCS National Championship Game. Plus, weekdays, stay on top of the action with College Football Live. The biggest names, the biggest games every Saturday. College football lives here, all season long, live on ESPN America.
NFL.com. Vote for the 2011 NFL Pro Bowl exclusively at NFL.com/Pro Bowl.
Shannon, good to see
you.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
This is the best year.
What was that? What is he doing? Why, hey, no, why didn't you blow the whistle?
Last play of the first half, Redskins lead it 3-0.
We got 30 seconds in the quarter.
Romo back to pass, pitches it off to Deshaun Choice. It's and on. That's going to be a fumble on the play. Oh, the one of the Redskins picks it up. It's the end zone. Oh, and he's going to go to the
All right. Yeah.
How about that?
Oh, that was big.
Mike Shanahan is one of 12 guys with multiple Super Bowl wins as a coach. He's also one of only 7 guys with multiple Super Bowl wins and 150 career wins overall, and he's done it in just 17 years, third shortest time. All right, so aside from the Donovan McNabb stuff, and we will talk about that later in the show. Guys, the Redskins are 4-4. They're an interesting team because they've beaten some teams, you know, that kind of surprised us, like the Packers. They've lost to some teams that surprised us, like the Lions. Steve, what is Shanny doing with this team?
Well, you know, he's taken over an abused team. I mean, even the owner's abused. I mean, they've, some of it self-abuse, but they are not culturally where Mike wants them to be. So this year is going to be a real up and topsy-turvy year. And so Mike is trying to get this team on course. And he doesn't have a real natural way to do it. He is not the kind of guy that's touchy-feely with it. It's like, look, you're a pro, do your job, come in and put the work in. If you don't do the work, then you're not going to be here next year. And I think he's got a lot of stick instead of carrot this year. And I think the teammate and this team is probably bristling against that a little bit. But in the end, he will win because he's a winner. And people will want him to be their coach in the future. They want to buy into it. This is just a transitional year for the Redskins in general.
In the end, is that what a team like this needs?
Absolutely. Like there's no question about it.
Absolutely. Go ahead, you know, it's interesting because Mike's trying to set a tone right here. And he does it a lot of different ways. And you saw when Haynesworth came in the beginning of the season and he did what he did. And I went through this similarly when Mike took his first head coaching job.
And the Raiders.
With the Raiders. And, you know, at one point I actually went into Mike's office and said, Coach, listen, I know you're trying to do all – we don't do that around here. That did not go over very well.
Yeah.
But he's going to do it his way, and there are expectations, and he wants it done properly, and he'll get it done. And when they do it that way, they will win consistently. He's proven that.
And it speaks to Donovan's benching, too. He wants it done, and he's not willing. He's willing to make no exceptions, and there's going to be examples made because my theory, my way of doing things works. It's proven. Everyone get on board.
You know, Shanahan's got more trouble than just what's up with the Donovan McNabb benching stuff. The Redskins, they are dead last in the NFL in third down conversions. But Washington fans, I do have a reminder and a hug for you. Way back when Shanahan first coached the Denver Broncos, his first season with Denver, his team was 8-8. The very next season, they went 13-3 and won the AFC West. Boom.
All right, Stu, nobody questions the fact that Mike Shanahan knows how to win in this league. Now, question, can the Minnesota Vikings 2010 edition win in this league? Brett Favre, Vikes, Soldier Field, Bears. They lost their last 8 road games. Jay Cutler didn't help. Kellen Davis, 19-yard touchdown, 27-13. About 8 minutes to go in the game. 14-point comeback a week ago. Short-circuited by Lance Briggs and company. Bears defense. 4 turnovers. 24 on the year. 2.5 to go. Favre over the middle. Picked off. Chris Harris. Brett threw for only 170. Vikes in trouble. 27-13. It's another 3-6 key. Should the Vikings, at what point do they see what their future is, and I mean beyond this year, maybe at quarterback with the very, maybe anything. Can they even think about that this year?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I think they should think about it right now.
Even with Brett sitting there.
He should be sitting in Minneapolis right now in Minnesota in his office trying to figure out how to put Tavares Jackson in the right spot so that he can succeed and help this football team win. And I know Brett Favre is a Hall of Famer, and he'll go in, and instead of 4 years, they'll shorten it and it'll be 2 years. I know all of that. I get all of that. But look at his play. He hasn't helped this football team win games like that. I mean, consistently this year. They paid him a bunch of money. They went out and got the private jet, gassed it up, gave him $20 million to win a championship, get to the Super Bowl. They're nowhere near close to that. Move forward with Tavares Jackson and start the process now if you think you're still going to be the head coach of the Minnesota Vikings.
Who's going to deliver that news to?
Me, Brad Childress. I'm going to the owner. We're going to talk. I'm going to tell you that I'm making a decision to bench Brett Favre because I want to look at Tavares, and I believe that he'll give us what we need.
And you believe that that would happen?
It
should
happen.
With the Brad Childress that's under fire right now, that's barely in the locker room himself.
I think he should.
I believe.
Look, Tommy, hold on, man. It's one thing. I've been here now for 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
You've taught me just wonders in television, okay? But at some point in time, you got to go. You don't have to
we
go.
We don't want to think about that now.
No, I'm just saying. At some point in time, you're going to have to go to give way.
Here's what I'm saying. Brett, because he's Brett, I believe is going to start consecutively 300 regular season games. That's going to take us to the second to the last game of the season. And I don't believe that anybody in that organization, maybe other than Ziggy, has the ability to walk in that locker room and tell Brett Favre, sit down on the bench. Anybody else? Yes.
What is Brett Favre scared to do it?
Listen, guys, Brett is NFL royalty. Let's stop. We had this conversation.
But see that royalty mess, man. You can't keep worrying about that.
You should have been here 4 years ago. We had this conversation. I was on another network.
Man.
We had this conversation. You can't. He was playing bad then.
Man, they not going anywhere.
When you go down to the farm and pick him up, this is what you sign up for. You sign up for the good and for the bad. Brett Favre cannot be benched. I don't care. Ziggy, no.
I'm pulling the trigger.
Chili, no. Coach.
I'm pulling the trigger.
Well, I learned a long time ago that used to is dead. Used to doesn't work anymore. What you used to do just doesn't work. Right now, it's 10 touchdowns, 16 interceptions. Now, I don't want to bench anymore. All I'm trying to say right now, you got to play the guy that gives you the best chance to win.
Yes.
If you think he gives you the best chance, play him. If you don't, give the other guy a chance. He might bring some enthusiasm to the offense we haven't seen. I don't know.
I'm sorry, but Brett right now is the walking wounded. I cannot line up in every play think, okay, his ankle's going to hurt, his shoulder's going to hurt. My other quarterback, he's not really prepared. He hasn't taken enough snap. I can't think of that as a head coach.
It also can't happen Packers week. You know that.
I don't care about – y'all think of this Packer record.
You need to be
Hall of Fame. They're not going anywhere.
Key, you cannot fire every coach. Let me teach you something. You cannot fire every coach, and you cannot bench Brett Favre. Those are the rules in the NFL.
Man, I'm benching Brett Favre, buddy. Period.
We'll
be mad at me all day long.
If the Green Bay game, which is this week in Minnesota, doesn't go well, and there's a couple others, who knows what the Minnesota landscape may be, if you will. At that, if the season's still going and the landscape changes, then we'll see. But Key, right now,
boom, I'm not going to let
you. Hold on, I got Ziggy on the phone here.
I'm not going to let you talk me into thinking that Brett Favre is going to come out and some magical thing is going to happen and he needs to continue to play.
What's that song say? Don't tug on Superman's cape. Don't spit into the wind.
Go on, bump this thing, Boom.
You have learned some television from Tom.
I don't like the fact that he mentioned me going.
Not right now. You're not rusty, Tom.
Believe me.
All these examples out there.
Key, you're making a lot of enemies in this section. I got to tell you, you're doing a hell of a job. Coming up on this show, if Key's back, the Patriots crushed the Steelers last night. Our reaction to a beat down at the big ketchup bottle. And... Michael Vick hops on John Gruden's bus. You like that quickness, don't you, Key?
There's not another place I would want to be in this world than playing on Monday night.
You are watching Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's.
The Falcons' Roddy White has developed into a star at wide receiver. He always had the blazing speed, and now boasts the reliable hands and sharp route running to be a Pro Bowler for years to come.
And ball's caught. White's got it.
White's rapport with Matt Ryan is as good as any quarterback-receiver duo in the NFL. In 2009, just their second season together, the wideout hauled in 11 touchdown passes.
And he's sacked, and that one belongs to the calf roping specialist, Jared Allen. Touchdown! 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 Cold-blooded connection.
What if I told you he wasn't the greatest? That a country would fail to protect its greatest natural resource? That sometimes it is a matter of life and death. That no one can outrun the truth. What if I told you he's the only true Cubs fan? That you could heal all wounds with a fight song? That the man no one could stop tragically was? What if I told you running a marathon is easy? 30 stories, 30 filmmakers, 30 years. ESPN's critically acclaimed 30 for 30. All this month on ESPN America.
The NHL is on ESPN America. Catch every team, every goal, and all the big games, including the playoffs and the Stanley Cup Finals. Plus, NHL on the Fly keeps you in the know. Looking for NHL action? The puck stops here. Hockey's best go head-to-head all season long, live on ESPN America, home of the NHL.
ESPN America Moments.
On first down, end zone, Knicks open. Touchdown.
ESPN's college hoop season begins with the College Hoops Tip-Off Marathon. 24 hours of nonstop college basketball starting tonight at midnight. Memphis takes on Miami. Ohio State, Florida, Butler, all of them in action against Butler, Louisville, Tom. Tonight's GMC Never Say Never Moments of the Weekend. Well, we're going to talk about it again. Mike was with us. Talk about Never Say Never Moments. David Garrard. And Mike Thomas is there on, as they call it, to highlight the rebote and the Jags win. And never say never for the Cowboys. Win number two this season came in Jason Garrett's debut as head coach. Five-game losing streak over as the Cowboys beat the Giants 33-20.
GMC, Never Say Never Moment of the Week, is brought to you by GMC. Check out the Never Say Never Moments of the Week at NFL.com/GMC.
Well, the twin brothers Ryan, Rex head coach Jets, Rob defensive coordinator Browns, exchanging pleasantries. Colt McCoy making it an overtime game, hitting Muhammad Massaquoi in the last minute of regulation. In the last 30 seconds of overtime, Mark Sanchez. Santonio Holmes gone. Game gone. Jets 26-20 winners. For more on the Sanchez, let's snap it to our quarterback, Trent Dilfer. Trent.
Thanks, Boom. Last year, we all witnessed young Mark Sanchez really mature into a fine young quarterback, especially in the playoffs. He made some outstanding plays in the playoffs, really under the bright lights of that moment. And it struck me, all those big plays he made were to the left side of the football field, and that trend has continued this year. In fact, I would say all of Mark Sanchez's signature throws to this point in his career are to his left. Go back to the New England Patriots game, 3rd and 1, trailing. He has Richardson wide open in the flat. Instead, he makes the aggressive throw to Dustin Keller down the football field while he's on the move. Now you go to the Miami game, 1, 3rd and 10, critical moment. The fade stopped on the left side, but look at this. He's keeping his eyes in the middle. Now Jason Allen takes his attention off Mark Sanchez and puts it on Braylon Edwards. This allows Mark Sanchez to get this ball into a tight spot on the perimeter of the back shoulder fade. Now you look at the Lions. This is a signature play for Mark Sanchez. DeAndre Levy's supposed to be dropping underneath Santonio Holmes, but he can't because Mark Sanchez's eyes are to the right. So when he wheels back to throw the left, he's able to throw the strike to Santonio Holmes to set up the game-winning field goal in overtime. And then against the Cleveland Browns, he recognizes the corner away from his arm will bail quicker. So now an on-time throw to Santonio Holmes allows him to get into the end zone and score the game winner. In the National Football League, when you're trying to find great players, you're looking for players that have rare and unique qualities. Mark Sanchez has the rare ability to be better to his left than he is to his right.
All right, Trent, snappy shirt. Snappy play last night for the Patriots at Pittsburgh. Patriots coming off a loss to Cleveland. What's wrong with the Patriots? Answer, nothing. Tom Brady, Rob Gronkowski. That would be a continuing theme on the night. 7-0 to the rookie, 19 yards. Tom Brady, Rob Gronkowski from the football playing NFL playing Gronkowski's. Touchdown, 17-3, 9-yard play. Tom Brady running it in. Oh, yeah. 23-3, Patriots over the Steelers at Heinz Field. Ben Roethlisberger, doink, picked James Sanders. Gone. 39-26 Patriots. Wow. A slice and dice in a game that was never in question. So now, actually, Key, I'm surprised to see you back this section. I wasn't sure. Reaction to that game, Coach. Welcome back, Key.
Well, you know, that old saying, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. You're not going to fool Bill Belichick twice. I tell you, I was so impressed to see this football team coming off the Cleveland loss. They went into Pittsburgh, and they put on a clinic. They did. They got ahead in the football game. They got Pittsburgh totally out of their offense, and it was over.
Too many miscues by the Steelers secondary. They allowed them now find this vertical passing game that's been missing since Moss. You know, sticking the ball in the gut of the running back, taking it out, throwing it deep on the post to tie it in through the seam. You can't have those mistakes, and it was too many miscues by that secondary.
New England early in the game, what they did was they had them Pittsburgh's defense booked, Tommy. They put their linebackers in pass coverage,
right,
and they isolated
right
the cornerbacks, and they took advantage of the linebackers in coverage compared to rushing, and they disregarded the run early, all right? Forget about that balance, and that's how they took advantage of the Steelers' defense.
You never saw James Harrison dropping so much into coverage rather than rushing the pass. Look, two things. Look at the Cleveland Browns and that win. They did two things. They ran the heck out of the football on the New England defense, and you got to pressure Tom Brady and knock him down on the ground. If you let him stand and read the field, he's going to burn you.
Here's what I know. Since 2003, after a loss, Belichick and the Patriots 23-2.
Yeah, well, good. There you go.
I mean, it's not an accident.
Yeah.
I mean, and for whatever reason, because the record is very impressive against Dick LeBeau, the best defenses for Pittsburgh, he has a feel, doesn't he? Like
yes,
they seem to understand what they're going to do, and it shows up every time.
But this was both sides of the ball. This was a clinic.
Yep, it was. It was impressive. 7-2, the Patriots. Well, if you haven't seen much of Michael Vick this season, you've been missing out. He's having the best season of his career. A comeback story on many levels. On the field, his speed and athleticism have reminded us of his days in Atlanta. Days our John Gruden remembers well, when he was coaching the Buccaneers. Here they are on the opposite sides again, this time on the Corona Light Bus.
Michael Vick races in for the touchdown, 17 yards.
I had to come up with a nickname for you. That's what I call you, Starship 7.
I like it, Coach.
You like it?
I like it.
Starship 7. Yeah, we're going to sell more awesome Starship 7 jerseys than Jaworski ever sold.
Man, I'm with you on that, Coach.
Man. I was really never worried about the Falcons too much, to be honest with you, until you showed up.
The feeling was mutual. You know, I used to hate to line up against Tampa Bay. It was probably
See, when you used to come out of that tunnel, I used to have to call my guys. I saw Vic here. I yelled across the field. I'd say, hey, Sapp.
Oh, man,
I got Brooks. You see these two guys? They were ready for you.
Oh, look at it. Look how they look. Look how they stand it. You think they're not ready?
They were ready. We worked all week on you, man. We had some battles, didn't we?
And it showed. We had some good ones.
Yeah, we did.
We had some good ones.
You used to tick me off. I mean, watch this. I mean, come on, man.
Yeah, that was sweet.
I mean, that's really sweet right there, huh?
Yeah, sometimes I got to watch it myself.
A couple years ago, man, I saw you come out of the tunnel with the Atlanta Falcons in the NFC Championship game.
Yeah.
You're coming out in Philadelphia, and you're going to play against Donovan McNabb for the right to go to the Super Bowl. And the Starship, they knocked you down and knocked you out.
They
beat you up that day. Donovan made a few plays in the passing game, and Philadelphia was off to the Super Bowl. And look at you two guys.
Yeah, it was unbelievable. That was my only shot. That was my only chance I had. You know, right then and there, I thought it would be easy to get back, but it only got harder. And that's the way this game is. And you know, it makes you appreciate everything that you accomplish now. And you know, you just want to always put your best foot forward and make sure that you do whatever you can to put yourself in a position to win.
But you know, you fast forward this life of ours, and now I see Donovan McNabb. He's running into Veterans Stadium, whatever you call that souped up rock and roll joint down there now. He's coming out there with the Washington Redskins.
Yeah.
And look who's quarterback in the Eagles, man. It's you. But he's out there talking to your receivers.
Exactly.
Before the game, that's like sleeping with the enemy or something. Like, what's going on here? It's a weird world.
It's a bizarre situation. And it's ironic that things turned out the way that they did. And it's very weird seeing Donovan in the Redskins jersey. And still weird to see me in a Philadelphia Eagles jersey.
Coming up, back to Washington for all the last-minute news and information you need to know before the game. Plus, halfway through a controversial first season in Washington, Donovan McNabb speaks on being benched before his Eagles rematch.
I wouldn't say unexpected, but, you know, it's an appreciation.
And the plays from the weekend that didn't quite go as planned. Don't miss one moment of...
Come on!
You know who I am, and you know what time it is. Come on, man!
Oh, look at that dude with the hair.
I can't believe what I'm seeing right now. Makes the hair stand up on the back of your neck.
This one has started out pretty.
Hear the drum!
As bad as it's been.
Oh! Can this get any worse? Pretty bad right there.
Makes a man look silly.
I cannot believe it.
Unbelievable. It just got worse.
Trying to do a little bit too much.
The hairstyle is not made by the ear, but by a person.
Give good fakes, you have good character. And obviously, Darren has great character because he delivers great fakes.
Thomas going to keep it. Oh, what a fake!
If we can cause any deception that forces the defense just to hesitate for a second, that may be the difference between a big gain or a tackle for loss.
I just put him in between, not knowing if the quarterback had the ball or the running back, so it make him just stop for a second, and all we need is that second.
With the play fakes, you really never know who has the ball, and he really does a good job making all the right reads.
Touchdown, Thomas!
Hello, nation!
Anyone?
Super.
Is that your real hair?
Yeah, that's my real hair. Can we get to sports, please?
Sports Nation? Bad news, 53%, but I think people were torn.
The nation says.
Are we on the air?
You've got to be kidding me.
Sports Nation, only on ESPN America.
Get it?
That felt good.
That felt good.
What is this guy doing?
I can't get through the gate. The gate is narrow.
Unbelievable.
back up. I'm stuck.
SportsCenter weekdays at 0700 CET on ESPN America. ESPN America Moments.
McCoy will throw it to Hillis. He's a very good receiver. With some running room. Colt McCoy extends. Touchdown.
So you think Donovan McNabb might be out to make a statement today?
Benched in his last game, Donovan McNabb aims for redemption against his former team.
Key, what do you think happens if he beats Philadelphia twice?
Smile. You see my face? That's what he's going to do. He's going to smile.
But will the Eagles continue to take flight with the electrifying Michael Vick and avenge an early season loss to an old friend?
Vick, he's fired. Touchdown to Sean Jackson.
Pressure's on the other guy, the coach and the quarterback.
The opportunity to sweep the team who didn't want you means a lot.
Eagles, Redskins, curtains up on an NFC East drama. Next on Monday Night Football.
Welcome back, everybody. Well, our nation's capital is filled with monuments, yet there hasn't been one in honor of the Redskins winning a Super Bowl since 1991. Yet, this season, there's hope. At 4-4, a win tonight would already surpass last year's total and pull Washington to within a game of the division lead. Of course, Philadelphia knows if they win tonight, they'll be tied atop the NFC East with the Giants, who the Eagles play next week. Now to our guys who never have a cardiovascular problem in the booth, Mike Tirico, Ryan Jaworski, John Gruden. No heavy breathing, guys, all right?
No, we'll try to make it through the entire two-minute drill in the game, Chris. Thank you very much. There's been the butt of jokes, a lot of different things. And, well, the Redskins give us another one. Guy gets benched 1 week. There's a bye week, and he's signed to a long contract. Let's go to the Donovan McNabb saga. And from what we talked to everyone this week about it, here's what we know. Before this game 2 weeks ago against Detroit, Mike Shanahan, the coach, went to McNabb, said, your hamstrings are bothering you. Maybe we should sit you this week. There's the bye the next week. This way we'd have you healthy for the second half of the season. McNabb wanted to play, and then you had the cardiovascular endurance that was brought up. And all of the things that Mike Shanahan was very candid. He said, I was clumsy in handling the explanation. Kyle Shanahan, Mike's son, the offensive coordinator, I thought said it best. And the most frank, he said, Donovan wasn't playing well. So somewhere in between there, the guy gets benched. We'll talk about the contract stuff as we roll through the game. But I want you to give me a little bit bigger picture here, John, because we have a quarterback with a great resume in McNabb and a head coach with a great offensive resume in Shanahan. We throw them on the same table, we think it's going to work, but it hasn't clicked so far. Give us some insight from your perspective on this.
Well, Donovan McNabb and Mike Shanahan were brought to the Washington Redskins to win and change the football culture. I hate to break it to you. It's not going to happen in 8 weeks. It's not going to happen overnight. It's going to be tough. There's going to be friction, and there's going to be frustration. I had it in Oakland when I was working with Rich Gannon. I have it every Monday night working with Jaworski. But when you combine Mike Shanahan with Donovan McNabb, you raise the urgency level, you raise the expectation, and there's a big reason right there why the Washington Redskins have a chance to sweep the Philadelphia Eagles this year.
Yeah, and Donovan McNabb has to learn a new system, and I think that's critical. People think of the West Coast offense of Andy Reid. They think of the West Coast offense of Mike Shanahan. They think they're the same thing. They are not. We asked Mike Shanahan on Saturday, what about the West Coast offense? He says, I don't even know what that means anymore. Everyone has new terminology, new ways of calling the plays, new passing concepts. And the one thing that I notice about what Donovan has to do here in Washington, as opposed to what he did in Philadelphia, it's the play-action passing game. That's predominant here in Washington. And he has to turn his back to the defense and find his receivers. It takes time to learn that. And he's getting better, but it takes time. As Coach said a little bit earlier, it's not going to happen overnight.
To kind of summarize all the people we spoke to and all we've observed here over these 3 days, Donovan hasn't played as well as he can, and the people around him aren't terrific. We have a ton of Pro Bowlers on this Redskin offense. Put it together, it's not the best situation yet. We'll see if it changes with the contract situation settled in the second half of the season. Boomer, see you at the bottom of the hour, the Eagles and Redskins.
All right, fellas, look forward to your call. As always, very interesting game, and now we've talked to all Redskins. Philadelphia Eagles, to me, Tommy, their excitement, if they keep them all together, well, how good can they be?
Well, Mike Vick, healthy.
Yep.
I think the sky is the limit. And you think about DeSean Jackson and Macklin and LeSean McCoy and Celek at the tight end, Mike Vick in it. All of them are in their prime. I mean, Mike Vick looks better than Mike Vick ever has. They stay healthy. Defensive side of the ball improves. Yeah, sky is the limit, especially when you look at the league as it is right now.
Tommy, when Bill Walsh invented the West Coast offense, he had Michael Vick, DeSean Jackson, and Macklin, all these guys in mind. Receivers on the outside who were very efficient in small spaces and could run after the catch. And a quarterback who was mobile, who could throw from the pocket, throw on the run, but ultimately under duress could advance the football with his feet. Michael Vick playing inside the pocket is a Bill Walsh dream. That's why they have the ability as an offense key to be really special.
With Michael Vick on the football field, this team is they're just fast. It's like playing basketball, fast break. Everything just speeds up. You look at the wide receivers, they get excited. They're making plays. The ball is delivered on time. They're catching, they're running, they're doing all sorts of things. But if this defense can somehow gel, boom, and put everything together, then the Philadelphia Eagles can be the team in the NFC Championship game that Andy Reid envisioned this year.
Well, stupid as this sounds, I agree with everything you say, but not because that you said something stupid, because I agree with you.
Too many laughs.
The Eagles are coming into this game, and the pressure's on them. I mean, let's face
yes.
it.
Yes. You know,
the
yes.
pressure's
yes.
on them. They've yes. already been beaten yes. in the division. The yes. Redskins will go to 3-0 if they win this football game. Eagles got the Giants next week, I believe. Hey, it's all on them. And this guy right there gives them a chance to beat, win any football game. Michael Vick is a special, special athlete.
You got to remember that Philadelphia, if you follow me, obviously I'm only talking two guys, have had four different starting quarterbacks this year. The season began. Kevin Cobb's your starter, hurt. Michael Vick is in. Oh, my goodness, he's playing great. Well, then he's hurt in this game at Washington game. Cobb, now you're the starter for a couple. Now Vick. That's hard for any team. I don't care how good they get. And any team's locker room might get fractured if there is a quarterback controversy or question. It's to the credit to the Eagles, Coach Reid, et cetera, mm-hmm. and the players mm-hmm. that they're all on the same page. And now if they get these guys together for 2 months, Vic
That's
just
right.
playing quarterback
That's right.
and all the guys that you guys are mentioning, it's exciting. Their turnovers are +9. It's the best in football. They still got to figure out inside the five. I mean, they just
boom.
David Akers has more 22-yard field goals from Louisville than anyone there is. And if they can figure that out.
Me and Kia write you up a little something you can take with you.
I've got a couple things. Conference.
What's wrong with them, Boom?
We went over this.
No, we were,
did I talk to him?
Some different stuff to go over him with.
Yeah, we got it. But as we point out, pressure. If they go 0-2 against McNabb, not
well,
what the plan was.
But
one last check on both parties before kickoff. Let's send a delivery down to FedEx Field. Michelle Tafoya with the Eagles. Michelle, good evening.
Good evening, Boomer. Well, the Eagles are without a couple of their starting defensive backs tonight. Right corner, Ellis Hobbs is out. He'll be replaced by Demetri Patterson. And free safety, Nate Allen, is out. And he'll be replaced by a rookie, Kurt Coleman. Now, Andy Reid told us last night, I can't say I'm not worried about Kurt Coleman. I mean, I know he was a starter and team captain and All-American at Ohio State. But this is the NFL. He's new. Donovan McNabb can wing it. I'm sure Kurt Coleman's going to get tested tonight. And defensive coordinator Sean McDermott added, this is a rookie making his first start in the NFL. It's Monday Night Football. There's a small concern. Now for an update on the Redskins, here's Susie Colbert.
Michelle, Mike Shanahan told me that Clinton Portis still needs another week to get his groin injury healed. But Ryan Tran, also back from injury, will start. And the biggest surprise is that dangerous return man Brandon Banks will start just 1 week after knee surgery. On the defense, defensive coordinator Jim Haslett said that this Eagles team reminds him of the Rams' greatest show on turf, only this is the fastest team he's ever seen. How do you defend speed? By being physical. Hit the wide receivers at the line of scrimmage. And if their quarterback, Michael Vick, wants to run and doesn't want to slide, make him pay. Hurt him, he said, which is exactly what they did in their last meeting in week 4.
With the second pick, the Philadelphia Eagles select Donovan McNabb.
McNabb rolling to the outside, coming back this way, is going to launch one. Mitchell making the catch.
That is amazing. That is Donovan McNabb.
The Eagles are headed to the Super Bowl. McNabb throws, touchdown, Philadelphia.
We've won. May not have won the Super Bowl, but we won.
With all due respect to Bubby Brister and Jaws, we're kidding, Jaws. Bubby's not even close.
Donovan is the greatest quarterback in Eagles history. 11 seasons in Philly. Donovan, first in attempts, completions, passing yardage, and passing touchdowns. He also led the Eagles to a Super Bowl in 5 NFC championship games. And no matter where he has played, Donovan has done two things: win football games and make headlines. In Detroit 2 weeks ago, he was benched, and the post-game explanations from the coaching staff only fueled the firestorm. McNabb, though, addressed the current controversy when he sat down with Mike Tirico.
Detroit, you find out Rex is going in for that second to last drive of the game. What was your reaction?
Well, a little shocked. It was the decision that he I guess, decided on, and I just went along with it. You know, you can only fight for so long, and then, you know, he makes the decisions.
Then we go the 48 hours after, and we hear everything from cardiovascular endurance, understanding the two-minute drill, hamstrings problem, all over the map with that. And Mike told me on Saturday, he said, no, it was clumsy, the way that I handled the explanation of it. What explanation did you get of how the thing was handled?
I kind of heard it like everybody else did. We talked about the whole incident. We talked about the decision. We talked about how I felt about it. And we were able to kind of clear the air. You know, being a player and a captain of the team, I just wanted to make sure that the team understood that wouldn't affect me, and that, you know, I will come back, you know, doing what I need to do in order for us to win.
You came into Philadelphia and got booed before they even knew you.
Right.
And then you left. And then at the end, you come back to play them, and they cheer you. What was it like to walk back and stand in midfield there and get that ovation?
It was a feeling that's kind of hard to explain. It kind of, I wouldn't say unexpected, but, you know, it's an appreciation of the 11 years that we've had, the highs and lows. I mean, we've had some great years in Philadelphia.
Michael Vick, go back to Michael's coming out of jail, and you put a little bit of your reputation neck on the line within the organization and say, you know what, we should bring him here. We can do this. Why'd you say those things?
Well, Mike is like a little brother to me. I've known Mike since he was a senior in high school. When he got out, I wanted to talk to Mike and let him know that, you know, everything that he set as his goal is still reachable, that you're going to work extremely hard, you know, keep your nose clean, and you'll get yourself back to where you want to be. He told me he would, and look at him now.
Less than a minute ago, as the Eagles were going back into their locker room before a pregame, a little bit of a scrum, some players and Redskin players. You see some taunting, some little shoves, but the crowd in this NFC East rivalry, everybody oohing and eyeing and paying attention. It happened in one of the corners of the end zone, again, as the Eagles were going back into the locker room just before the game. Didn't really see much going on. But guys, when you see something like that, and we all know, not a big deal in the overall scheme, but what does that mean for the
hey, look, I'll tell you, I like it. Game. Your old team, the Redskins, that you played for a couple years, I like that they showed something. This team for a long time has been too flatlined, so hey, that's good for me.
Well, for me, it's just emotion. It's the emotion of the game, and to me, it speaks of Monday Night Football. I mean, that's what it's all about right there. If you can't get hyped up for this thing, and, you know, somebody says whatever they say, it doesn't really matter what word you said.
No one ever understands.
It's time to get juiced.
What did you say? Most of the fights are, what did you say? I don't know. What did you say?
Now, as a coach, Andy Reid, what are you thinking when, yeah, it's going on, blah, 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 but you see your number 7 quarterback who's standing there in the middle of it?
Well, he was trying to walk past. That was the problem. They were coming out to warm up. They wanted their space. The Eagles were leaving the field, so they had to get off the field. And one lineman said, hey, that, you know how linemen are. That's my spot. So it wasn't about any one person.
I think that's good stuff. I think it's only going to help the game.
Help the game.
It's funny.
Who might that emotion help more?
Whoever's ready for it. That stuff, you know, the funny thing about that, we see it, and everybody gets all excited about it. And it is, you know, it's Monday Night Football. There's a lot of juice going on. But when the ball's kicked off, all this stuff is gone. This means nothing. You better concentrate on the job you have. You know what I like right there? Garth DeFelice, the umpire, he's right in the middle of the scrum, and that's what a good umpire, see him right in the middle there?
Yep.
That's what a good umpire should be doing.
And it was actually both Eagle quarterbacks. You saw Michael Vick, Kevin Cobb, who Matt and I both noticed, bigger than you might expect.
Man.
He was also standing there.
Just timing.
All right, controversy quarterback. Here in Washington, D.C., when you have a team that's 4-4 and a team that's struggling, and you're playing a big division rival game like this, what does the Monday night stage do as far as looking at records and who's supposed to win?
I think the Monday night stage, you can take the stage and get rid of everything. Get rid of the records, get rid of, you know, being benched, get rid of whatever, because now is the time to shine. And each game is your opportunity to start fresh and new, and tonight we roll.
Now, I could see you being in the middle of something like that before a game. When you all played with the 49ers, let's say you all were playing the Cowboys, there's a little jawing. What would you have done if you had seen Steve in the middle of it jawing as well?
I'd have grabbed him and gotten him out of there.
Yeah, like, what are you, stupid? You're only 6'3", I mean 6'1".
Yeah, exactly.
Big games are all about emotion, to Matt's point. Really, you think about the NFC East is up for grabs right now for all these teams. And so, you know, you get into these NFC battles, it's a big deal. Good for them.
All right, Redskins playing for the 60th time on Monday Night Football. With more NFL Bears, we'll send it back to the fellas, Morton and Adam. Guys,
thanks very much, Stu. Lots of quarterback issues around the league. The Dolphins have put Chad Pennington on IR with a season-ending shoulder injury that threatens to end his entire career, going down early in the game yesterday. Obviously, they depended on Chad Henne to come in and replace him, but Henne suffered a knee injury of his own. Not likely that he'll play on Thursday night, but it's not a season-ending injury. In the interim, on the short week, Tyler Thigpen is expected to be the starter for the Miami Dolphins on Thursday night against the Chicago Bears. But today, the Dolphins signed Patrick Ramsey to the roster and Tom Brandstetter to the practice squad.
Adam, it's not a bad thing that Tyler Thigpen is playing. He's actually the most mobile of all those quarterbacks. Has had some success on the field. It's good because left tackle Jake Long not only dislocated his shoulder, when he dislocated it, he suffered some damage to his labrum. Now, they're going to try and holster it up and maybe play him, but he's probably going to miss this Thursday night game against the Bears, maybe with Julius Peppers lining up over there.
More than a night when we're talking about the Redskins' current quarterback, Donovan McNabb, their former quarterback, Jason Campbell, has been named the Raiders' starting quarterback for Sunday's game against the Pittsburgh Steelers. Campbell has led the Raiders to victories in each of the last three games, a 5-1 touchdown to interception ratio. He's played very well, and the Raiders recognize that they're sticking with him and not turning back to Bruce Gradkowski, despite the fact that Gradkowski had a lot of support within the organization.
And Lions quarterback Matthew Stafford made a reluctantly scheduled visit to Dr. James Andrews today to check out his grade 3 separated shoulder. Even though it's not supposed to be bad, as say Sam Bradford's was a year ago at Oklahoma, he still could have surgery depending on how Dr. Andrews manipulates that shoulder and determines how much range of motion he has. Maybe you just get it fixed once and for all. Very unlikely that Stafford plays again this year, Boomer.
All right, guys, thank you. A lot to keep up with, that's for sure. Coming up, Cowboys have been a come-on-man staple this season, replacing Tom's Raiders. Were they spared after a win this week? And we'll head back to the field to show you the players as they warm up or scrap up or whatever they do. All the last-minute info you need to know before the Eagles and the Redskins exchange pleasantries. We'll be back.
Game Time Decision is brought to you by Campbell's Junkie, the answer to your dinner decision. Matt Ryan may have the best nickname among all of the NFL's quarterbacks, Matty Ice. It suits him. The Falcons star is a cool customer whenever he drops back to pass.
Matt looks, throws, end zone! Touchdown!
Matty Ice threw for over 6,300 yards in his first 2 years in the league, and in doing so, led his team to their first back-to-back winning seasons in franchise history.
Don't sit back there with indecision. Safeties, make a damn call. Let's go. They're back there having a damn tea party.
You okay? Huh? Didn't understand that answer. Damn. Come on, stand there, Jake.
Bring it back here. Bring it back. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Bring it all the way back. All the way back. Let's go.
Fan, fan, fan.
Ah, shoot.
Bring it back.
Play it again. That's terrible. It's the 21st practice, and we got
8 guys leaving at the different times.
Come on, guys. This is not an exercise in futility. Holy smokes. Omar, give him the ball so he can run with it, will you please?
They're getting tired. It's hot. They're tired, hot. They're not thinking, so it's not processing.
All right, now that's like the dumbest thing we can do. You guys understand? But that's why we're practicing. It'd rather be dumb right here in the heat of Spartanburg than out on some game field in the NFL.
A player who makes the team great is better than a great player.
If the ball gets there before you, then you beat the hell out of it. But if you're on the ball like you were there, you poke for the ball. You put your hand in his hand. Yep.
On Goose versus Tampa, don't be in a hurry. Don't be in a hurry.
Let him wait.
Well, that's why I say manipulate him. Yeah. Come off of it and then do that with the safety. Boom! And then down the middle.
Okay. Over here. Oh, what the hell?
This November on ESPN America, it's an action-packed fall, and we've got it all. It's time to get ready for the NFL's Thanksgiving feast. College football's biggest rivalries take center stage. And we're back on campus as the new college hoop season gets underway. Plus, the superstars of the NHL kick it into high gear. The brightest stars, the biggest games, all this month live on ESPN America. ESPN America Moments.
LeBron for three.
Yes, sir!
How about that, boy? Welcome to the LeBron Dick James Show.
A 14-point third quarter for LeBron James.
Come On Man is brought to you by Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
Well, you voted Andrew Ryan or Reed as your Come On Man of the Week. Did I talk to him? Andy's always been a little larger than life, even as a 13-year-old in L.A. Punt, pants, and kick.
You sure that's not Merlin Olsen?
Go online and vote for your favorite Come On Man of Week 10. That was fun. Andy said they had fun with them all week in the locker room, and the fun stops tonight. You can see with the skirmish between the teams. All right, so Come On Man, what do we got, Key?
Come On Man, the Miami Dolphins and Randy Moss's newest team, the Tennessee Titans. Randy Moss gets hit right here, drops the football. Okay, take a close look. David Stewart Lyman decides, I'm going to come in and I'm going to hit somebody late. Flag on the play. Jeff Fisher saying to himself, hey, the whistle blew. What are we doing? This was just like WWE style. Got him. What are you doing, Stewart? Come on, man.
Key, let's stay at that same game. Brandon Marshall, now, he's still searching for a quarterback to get him the ball, but look at him rifle the ball over the sideline. It's costing him an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty. But later on in the game, the Dolphins actually take advantage of Brandon's ability to throw the ball downfield into triple coverage, but he almost got it there. Give me a quarterback, he's saying. Come on, man.
Tommy, I'm going to Jacksonville. Now, this is how you lose a football game. Texans driving, trying to win. Oh, coughed it up. All right, 3 seconds to go. Antonio Swift, he wants to make a contribution to the loss. So he jumps offside. That might make him like 5 yards closer on the Hail Mary. David Garrard steps up in the pocket. Throws the Hail Mary. Tommy yelling, knock it down. knock it down. Knock the ball down, son. That's what Tommy's been saying. Don't knock it that way, because there's receivers right there. Get a big guy back there. Coach, come on, man.
The Lions have a 2-point conversion here. Sean, here, watch him. Scrambles out of the pocket. He's trying to get the ball. Johnson throws it to the cameraman. You can't do that. You got to give the guy a chance. Come on, Sean. Come on, man.
We go to Denver, where the whooping was on early. Kyle Orton, third touchdown pass. of the first quarter to Jabbar Gaffney, but Todd Haley, look at it, fires it better than Marshall. I'm challenging that. There's no way. And then Mike Carey, the ref, says we've had a look, kind of.
The replay system was inoperable. Therefore, the ruling on the field stands. It's a score.
And what does he say, Key? Come on. Oh, we didn't see it.
Come on. Poor Mike Carey. He's in the middle of a lot of those.
He is.
He's been on. He's been on four times this year.
Yeah, he's nice.
And it didn't work, huh? Didn't work for the home team. Hey, come on, man.
Something new.
Interesting. Well, from that come on, man, to our nuttiest fans, nuts in the stands or nuts on the sidelines. Oh, there you go. Our Snickers nuttiest fan. Look at it. I think he's related to the weasel, that guy. Who is that? All right, now we go to our Snickers field pass. Tom, you might have heard Donovan McNabb's playing for the Redskins this year.
Yeah,
I think.
Boone playing, and he really does have to play better. I know that he doesn't have a great supporting cast around him, but third down conversion is something to keep an eye on tonight. He's got to be able to keep his team on the field and keep the chains moving. Just watch that as you watch the game tonight.
Our next on the field is a left-handed QB who can run like the wind. Let's see which one of our analysts should comment, Steve.
Well, Stu, I don't know if you saw the clinic put on by Tom Brady last night, but it was driven by footwork and eye level. Tom's the best at it, which drives accuracy. What I've seen from Michael this year so far has not shocked me, but close to shocking at how much he has grown. His eye level is always up. His footwork is driven his accuracy to be one of the best in the game. If he keeps this up, I talked to Marty Morningwake earlier today, his coach. He says he keeps this trajectory up, he could be one of the best in the game.
Second-year Redskin linebacker Brian Arakpo has 7 sacks this year. Matt Millen, what do you like about what Big Fella's doing?
He's gotten better. I mean, he's taken a jump from last year where he had an outstanding rookie year to this year. He's 6'4", 260 pounds. He moves around on that defense. You have to account for him. He's got a great blend of power and speed. He will be a factor tonight.
Well, Matt, LeSean McCoy, one of the young skill players that the Eagles have on offense, Key.
You know, Boom, if he can continue to play as well as he's been playing all year long tonight, he'll give the Philadelphia Eagles that added boost that they need, like a running back like LaDainian Tomlinson, that second guy that can catch the football out of the backfield, as well as Frank Gore of the San Francisco 49ers. These guys are special. They're dual threats. They can run. They also can catch. It'll help the Eagles tonight if he can do that.
Some of the questions, Coach, about the Skins are, do they have enough weapons? Well, Chris Cooley at tight end is a pretty good one.
He's a very good one. He's an H-back type, but he runs great routes. He has a great feel for the zone defenses, but he's capable of beating man coverage. But he finds the hole. This is a guy right here that's got to make Donovan McNabb look good on third down right here.
Chris, if there's a guy that can play at the same speed as Michael Vick, it might be DeSean Jackson, the Phillies wideout.
Very few people in the league can match that type of speed. Boom. Also, people talk about swagger. The Philadelphia Eagles, this is the guy, 160 pounds. He gives the Eagles all the swagger they need.
Well, if you talk about swagger, Chris, how about a guy that picked off 4 in one game, tying an NFL record first set by a Redskin, you might remember, Sammy Baugh. That's D'Angelo Hall.
D'Angelo Hall having the best year of his career. His only problem has been his focus. This year, focus, 6 interceptions, the most in his career, 5 in the last 2 weeks. Stay focused, D'Angelo.
All right, there's your field pass. Coming up earlier tonight, the Eagles and Redskins. Of course, they were nose to nose, weren't they? Exchanging early holiday gifts. There you go. That's what we're talking about. How's it going on the way into the locker room to get set for this thing? It's kind of like this set after Key called everybody out. Who wins this intense rivalry game? We'll be back.
You are watching Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's. The Colts' Peyton Manning may be the NFL's biggest star, and his numbers suggest the 4-time league MVP could wind up the greatest quarterback of all time. Manning enters the 2010 season trailing only John Elway, Dan Marino, and Brett Favre in career passing yards. But numbers only tell part of the story. Manning was the MVP of Super Bowl 41, and after falling short in Super Bowl 44,
He's hungry for a second world title.
Is on ESPN. Every Sunday, Chris Berman and the gang get you primed for all the matchups on the 25th season of Sunday NFL Countdown. Then, catch a triple header of the best games from across the league. And when the weekend's over, the action is far from it. Monday Night Countdown gets you pumped for Monday Night Football Live. So if you're looking for NFL action, look no further. We've got it all, including the playoffs, the Pro Bowl, and the Super Bowl. Football's best go head-to-head all season long, live on ESPN America, home of the NFL.
Marlon Briscoe broke down barriers in 1968 when he became the first black quarterback of the modern era with the AFL's Denver Broncos. When starter Steve Tensi went down with an injury, Briscoe stepped in. He threw 14 touchdowns and over 1,500 yards in 11 games. After being released by Denver at the end of his rookie year, he played eight more seasons in the NFL, including a 1970 Pro Bowl season with Buffalo and two Super Bowl championships with the 1972 and 73 Dolphins as a wide receiver. He never played quarterback again, but in just 11 games, Briscoe blazed the trail and made an impression that will last for generations to come.
Countdown is served by Applebee's. Try Applebee's new flavor-loaded steaks. Come see what's cooking today. And in part by GMC. Enter the Never Say Never sweepstakes for a chance to win a GMC Sierra Denali at gmc.com/NFL. And Snickers. Go nuts with Snickers for your chance to go to Super Bowl 45. Visit NFL.com/Snickers to enter.
I'm Steve Young.
I'm Herm Edwards.
I'm Trent Dilfer.
I'm Keyshawn Johnson.
And we're bringing you an exciting show called Audibles.
But here's the kicker. You control the show.
They're not going to win this week.
They don't do the ugly stuff.
I think that could be a real problem.
Wait, are you losing your mind? Bam! You're going to get hit.
Jump on Twitter.com/ESPN and Facebook.com/ESPN. Call an audible. Change the direction of the show, and we will talk about what you want to talk about.
Look at you, West Coast guy. You hosted that show, Key? Well, Stewart's got the lead. Tom took a shot last week.
Yeah.
But since he's a hometown, but didn't quite work, Stewart now has the lead. Everybody over 500. Steve, you have the lead here. You got the tee box. Who do you like tonight, my friend?
Tough Boomer, my old JV coach at BYU, Andy Reid, and Mike Shannon, my Super Bowl coach. A lot of emotion for me. I'm not going to go with my heart, though. I'm going to go with my head. The Eagles have too much speed, and Michael Vick is too good right now. I pick the Eagles tonight.
I think Donovan McNabb's going to have a better game than he had the last time, but I think Michael Vick is going to trump him, and I'm going with the Eagles.
Michael Vick has averaged more yards in his career per rush, 7.2, than pass, 6.6. But this year, he's averaging 8 yards per pass and still 7.3 per rush. I got to go Vick, Eagles.
Well, if the Eagles want to keep pace with the Giants, they got to win this football game. That's all there is to it. I'm going with the Eagles.
Well, now that everyone's telling the truth in Washington, I'm going to skin. Sign this for me,
oh, no
please.
Problem. I'm going to sign it just like McNabb. That made his heart feel better, but that hammy is still hurt. I'm going with the Eagles, Tommy.
Talking about keeping pace, I'm trying to keep pace now with the guys at the top. That's Stu. So I'm picking the Eagles.
Eagles, they're going to have a tough – it's as tight as it can be. They got a game Monday, Sunday, Sunday, Thursday. So the next four games are in 18 days. They need to start off sharp.
I think it's very exciting to watch them the next couple of months. 24-17 Philadelphia. We well, you could see it's a divisional rivalry when the guy scuffle right before the game. What does that mean?
Nothing.
Wasted energy is what
wasted
it means.
Energy. Wasted energy. I never energy. Did that.
All right, now that we agree on that.
Never did that.
No. David, you can hit somebody.
I was never concerned about a guy wanting to fight me before the game. I was concerned about the guys wanting to fight during the game.
Thanks for watching Monday Night Countdown. See you at prime time at halftime in the fastest three. Monday Night Football coming up next.
Leaders aren't born, they're made.
I have to stay strong in body and mind.
Rebound from setbacks, rise to the occasion.
With electricity
and fire.
Compete,
commit,
and come through.
I know him.
He's like me.
Michael Vick.
Donovan McNabb.
For 60 minutes.
Friends for 13 years, their thrilling and star-crossed careers intersect again. Donovan McNabb of the Washington Redskins, Michael Vick of the Philadelphia Eagles. Quite a matchup for you tonight, just outside of D.C., as we welcome you to ESPN's Monday Night Football launch, engineered by GMC. So many storylines on the plate for us here tonight. Let's start with the main one. The game and the standings. Eagles win. They're 6-3, tied with the Giants atop the NFC East, and the Giants come to see Philly on Sunday. For Washington, win tonight. They'll pass last year's win total of 4. They'll only be a game out in the NFC East, and they'll have swept Philadelphia. How sweet that would be for Donovan McNabb, who was traded from Philly after 11 good years to Washington on Easter Sunday. Let me bring you Ron Jaworski and John Gruden, because there's a lot more that needs explaining, like this. Donovan McNabb, last game 2 weeks ago, benched in Detroit after the fourth quarter. And then tonight, McNabb gets a contract extension after we're talking about him being benched. How do we explain that?
This is the Washington Redskins. They don't do anything by the book. Last year, they signed Albert Haynesworth, gave him $100 million. He doesn't even start in their base defense. But I think there's three issues with Donovan McNabb, and it starts with his health. He's had some lingering hamstring problems that have really inhibited his play. He's not 100% tonight. Secondly, he's learning a brand new offense, and you'll see for yourself tonight, this is a lot different than the offense he ran for the last 11 seasons in Philadelphia. And thirdly, his supporting cast here is a work in progress, particularly the offensive line. They gave up 7 sacks the last time out against the Detroit Lions. But here's what I do know. For the Redskins to win, Donovan McNabb has got to play better.
It's kind of strange because a year ago tonight, McNabb was playing mentor, if you will, to Michael Vick. Now, just look at last week as Vick comes back off the rib injury. Michael Vick is running this offense perhaps better than McNabb did, and he's playing as well as he did back in his first run in the NFL.
Mike, when I look at Michael Vick now, I see a professional quarterback. Andy Reid has molded Vick into a prototypical NFL pocket passer. In fact, if you look at Vick's 7 touchdown passes this season, they've all come from the pocket. And he's a progression reader. He'll go to number 1, number 2, number 3, and then he'll use that quick twitch that is now back to bolt from the pocket and make those exciting plays outside the pocket. When he's outside the pocket, that's when the fun begins.
And the numbers tell the story as well as we take you into the Verizon Red Zone. Michael Vick this season, put all the stats together, you get the passer rating. His is the best of the National Football League. He's thrown 125 passes, has not been intercepted. As Jaws alluded to, all of his touchdown passes from the place he used to struggle, the pocket. You'll see it all in HD tonight, our Redskins-Eagles telecast, brought to you in high definition by Verizon. Back just outside our nation's capital in 30 seconds.
Hello, nation.
Anyone?
Super. Nation says.
Are we on the air?
You've got to be kidding.
Sports Nation, only on ESPN America.
A
Oh, the storylines are out there, and so is the emotion. This is pregame. DeSean Jackson woofing with LaRon Landry. They'll see each other when the Eagles have the ball on offense, and both teams coming together towards one of the tunnels. Just coming up tonight. Welcome back. Time now for Miller Lite. Taste greatness, and let's talk. What as I watch the guys around him, they're level now.
Yeah, probably the offense in the NFL, and Michael Vick's mobility better. The one thing Michael's terrific at is man-to-man coverage. In the shotgun, once he drops back and identifies man-to-man, he will dart from the point. Knows the defenders have their back turned to him. This mobility sets up the running game beautifully because he calms down the defense. Pursue from the backside, and the benefit is LeSean McCoy. You'll see the handoff here, but the backside cannot pursue because they're concerned about Michael Vick's ability to bootleg outside the pocket. You get the nice McCoy, takes it to in Michael Vick. Jackson from the pocket. Calmness. Look at the delivery, and boy, you see the Eagles offense. John Jackson.
I think it's important is to do what they did the first time out of the Philadelphia Eagles, and that is pick up the blitz and handle it. You can run the football, see the load, and run it away from the overload. You can make big plays on the ground. Secondly, pick it up. Give Donovan McNabb time to look down the field and make big plays. And finally, if there's nothing there, let Donovan McNabb do what he's done for the last 12 years. Beat the blitz with his legs and scramble for key first downs. The Philadelphia Eagles are bringing it tonight, and how well the Redskins handle the pressure is going to determine the outcome of this game.
Vic against McNabb, nothing like NFC East matchups, huh? With storylines on top. Eagles Redskins coming up next on Monday Night Football.
You've been watching ESPN's Monday Night Football Lodge, engineered by GMC, the official vehicle of Monday Night Football. NFL is on ESPN America. Every Sunday, Chris Berman and the gang get you primed for all the matchups on the 25th season of Sunday NFL Countdown. Then, catch a triple header of the best games from across the league. And when the weekend's over, the action is far from it. Monday Night Countdown gets you pumped for Monday Night Football Live. So if you're looking for NFL action, look no further. We've got it all, including the playoffs, the Pro Bowl, and the Super Bowl. Football's best go head-to-head all season long, live on ESPN America, home of the NFL.
Monday Night Football.
What a show this man has put on tonight.
ESPN welcomes you to the following presentation of the National Football League.
Unbelievable! September 16th, 2002. On this night, two of the league's oldest franchises met in a classic NFC divisional battle in the nation's capital. Eagles quarterback Donovan McNabb accounted for over 300 yards, throwing for two touchdowns and running for another as the Eagles jumped out to a 23-7 halftime lead and never looked back, winning 37-7. McNabb's career in Philadelphia would be remembered for five trips to the NFC title game and one Super Bowl appearance before being traded to the rival Skins in the spring of 2010. Now, once again, it's the Eagles and the Redskins. Are you ready?